In this video, we qualitatively discuss the property called self-inductance for a solenoid. Then we derive and apply the formula for the self-inductance to an example. As a quick reminder, in the picture on the left, we have a solenoid that's just a long coil of wire. And we previously discussed that a current-carrying solenoid has a uniform magnetic field inside, and that's given by the formula B equals mu naught Ni, where mu naught is called the permeability of free space. Little n is the number of turns per unit length, or turns per meter, for the coil, and I, of course, is the current. But now that we know a little bit about induction, we realize that connecting a solenoid to a power source creates a bunch of new flux through the turns in the coil. That's going to induce an EMF, fighting the change in flux through each of those turns. And this is the idea of Lenz's law. This induced EMF will then slow the increase in current as the solenoid gets up and running. Conversely, once current is running in a solenoid, if we suddenly switch off the power source, an EMF will be induced that tries to maintain the current flowing in the same direction it was to begin with, because it's fighting any change of flux through the coils. This resistance to changes in current is quantified as the self-inductance of the coil. So how do we measure self-inductance? We're going to start from Faraday's law. And Faraday's law is quantifying the induced EMF. If I have a known change in flux for each of the loops in the coil, N is the number of loops in the coil, and delta T, of course, is the time for the change in flux to occur. But this delta phi in the coil, that's, again, the change in flux per loop, so for an individual loop, and we multiply by N later in Faraday's law, the change in flux is certainly related to the current in the coil. And I'm going to write it first as A times B final minus A times B initial. There I'm using the formula for flux that is given by the area of a loop times the intensity of the magnetic field. And when the magnetic field is perpendicular to the loops like it is in this case, it's that simple to measure flux. But then I can relate the field inside this coil to the current running through it by using our first formula. And I find that my change in flux is given by A mu naught N times the change in the current. This allows me to go back to Faraday's law and change the appearance of that a little bit. And our goal here, by the way, is to find a relationship between the induced voltage and the rate of change in the current. So I replace delta phi with A mu naught N times delta I. And now I've got an induced EMF in the coil as being proportional to the rate of change in the current. There's one more modification to make to get this in its final form. Instead of writing little n in here, I can re-express it as the total number of turns divided by the length of the coil. And that allows me to combine two factors of capital N, the total number of turns. So I get negative mu naught n squared A over the length of the coil, and I'm going to use a lowercase l for this because we need capital L for something else, times delta I over delta T. I'll just change that L over real quick. So this constant of proportionality, when I get the induced EMF proportional to the rate of change in current, the constant of proportionality is called the inductance or self-inductance of the coil. And that's a way of quantifying how intensely this coil is going to resist changes in current. If my self-inductance is bigger, it means for a given change in current, I'm inducing a bigger EMF to resist that change. And we commonly use the symbol capital L for self-inductance. So for a solenoid, capital L is given by mu naught N squared A over L. Little L for the length of the solenoid. So the units of inductance can be expressed in terms of this induced EMF that has units of volts. And over here on the right-hand side, my change in current over change in time, that's amps per second. So for the self-inductance to produce volts out of this, I need volt seconds per amp as the units. And there's a special name for this. It's called the Henry, and it's a capital H. Finally, I can rework my induced EMF formula. And if I just talk about magnitudes here and ignore the minus sign is really just telling us that the induced EMF always resists the change in flux. If I just write down a formula in terms of magnitude, it's just this. The induced EMF is given by the inductance L times the rate of change in the current. And again, a bigger L means you get a more intense induced EMF resisting the change in current. And I can also see from the formula the big rate of change in the current induces a larger EMF, which makes a lot of sense. So let's wrap things up by applying our inductance formula to a solenoid. And we're given a solenoid with a length of 10 centimeters, a number of turns, 2,900. Average diameter of the coils, 2.9 centimeters. And of course, we can use that to find the area of those coils. Area will be 1/4 pi diameter squared. That's the same thing as writing down pi r squared. And I get 1/4 pi times 0.029 squared. And that comes out to 6.61 times 10 to the negative 4 square meters. Then I can compute the self-inductance of this coil using our new formula. That's mu naught n squared a over l. And I'll crunch those numbers. And I get a self-inductance of 0.0699 henries. And you would normally express that in millihenries as 69.9 millihenries. Next, we're told that this coil had a DC current of 0.5 amp flowing through it. And we're trying to compute the induced EMF if we shut the current down in 1/100 of a second by unplugging the solenoid. So in this case, we're talking about the EMF that's induced to attempt to keep the current flowing in the coil. And we use our new formula for the induced EMF in terms of the self-inductance. That's L delta I over delta T. My self-inductance is 0.0699 henries. My change in current is 0.5 amp. And my change in time, we shut this thing off in 1/100 of a second. And when I crunch the numbers, I get 3.50 volts induced to try to keep this current flowing. This, by the way, is the reason why when you unplug appliances that are already running, you frequently will get a spark jumping from the outlet to the cord. It's that current attempting to continue moving even as you're shutting things down. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.